Grace and peace to you on this day from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. When you're in the Milwaukee airport and you come through security, they have a recombobulation area. As of this morning, and I looked it up and checked my numbers once more, in our country to date, in 2015, there have been 13,678 homicides. I checked with gunviolencearchive.org. Up to now, in 2015, there have been 10,746 deaths by use of a gun. It's about 1,000 a month. Of them, children from age 0 to 11, 580 deaths. Teenagers, 2,142. There have been 275 mass shootings. Think of the community college in Oregon and Emmanuel A&E in Charleston among them. Somehow involving law enforcement, 3,591. Home invasions, 1,818. Self-defense, 927. Accidents, 1,528. And add to those 10,746 deaths, non-fatal injuries, 21,685. We have a problem, don't we? And we don't seem to have a way to fix it. On one side, people will say, well, if we just had better laws, if we just restricted the guns people could have, we wouldn't have as much violence or as much death. And on the other side say, well, hold on a second, the people that follow the laws aren't the people that have the issue. We need a better criminal justice system, and we need better help for those with mental illness. And because both sides in our country and the divisions we have politically don't talk to each other, we're at a complete standstill. And meanwhile, our people are dying. I find it interesting, I read this yesterday, that as people call for tighter gun control, gun ownership is actually going up. And I think I've got the reason why. If the chief role of the government is to keep us safe, and no one is keeping anybody safe, people are seeking to protect themselves, leading to a host of all kinds of other issues, right? We start to look at each other with fear, with antagonism, with angst, with anger, and either that certain kind of paranoia, or just looking out for ourselves and hoping to make it through the next day and not get ransacked by some weirdo. It's a problem. There were two news stories that really captured my interest this week. The first one was in Fort Worth, Texas, the guy driving the pickup truck and the motorcycle who was going to Casting. Did you see this story? Yeah. And as the motorcycle with two riders was going to pass him, he swerved into the other lane to knock them off. And they tumbled and they rolled. Now, thankfully, they were relatively okay. I mean, minor injuries. But they could have been killed easily. And when confronted, the driver said, I don't care. That's a problem. I saw this other story, and you probably saw it too, of a family who picked up their young daughter after school. They were taking her home. She asked to sit closer to her brother in the back seat. The parents said, no, sit in your normal spot. And because of this road rage incident, someone pulled out a gun and shot at them and killed this little girl. That's a problem. And then the parents afterwards, in their grief and in the horror of what had happened, trying to make some sense out of it, felt this incredible wave of guilt, saying if we just let her sit next to her brother, maybe she would have been okay. We live with fear and anger and rage. Fear of the other, fear of ourselves. We're not sure what's going to happen next. You turn on the news, it gets worse and worse every day, doesn't it? It seems like it. So why am I telling you this? Something you probably already know. Why, Pastor, would you tell us this morning when we have these beautiful passages from Scripture that don't seem to have anything to do with it? Well, I have three reasons. The first reason is we should talk about it. This is the world we live in that is broken and sinful and in a lot of pain. And we need to come to grips with the reality of what that means and our own participation in it, even if on the sidelines. The second reason is, I don't know about you, but I think we can do better than this, can't we? Are we called to a different kind of life? I mean, it's Reformation Sunday. We think about Martin Luther and the great hymns and all the 95 theses, and maybe we should be talking more about that. But his great discovery or rediscovery was this whole point that it's not up to us, that we live because God gives us life. We are called holy by God, not because we get it right, not because we can even do it, but because Jesus comes to us, lives alongside us, dies for us, raises us up to a new kind of life. Yes, in the hereafter, but also now. And the third reason is I think these passages from Scripture are about this. This first passage from Jeremiah, it sounds lovely. It's a great little poem, isn't it? About bringing everybody back together. But why? These are people that experienced a lot of death, murder even. They were invaded. They lost everything. They lost their homes, some lost their families, some lost family members and friends. They lost their land. They lost their ability to worship. They were taken away to a foreign place, so they lose their culture and their language too. And there, in the midst of all of that heartache and pain and suffering, comes the promise to gather together, that God is in the midst of them. God will lead them home. The song, God is our help in trouble. I like that song. I think Luther liked it too. He reflected on those words when he was in hiding in the Wartburg Castle and wrote, "The mighty fortress is our God," to that song. The kingdom's ours forever, it ends. That's a pretty inspiring notion. In the midst of his world that had gone crazy over all the things that were happening around him. This passage from Titus, Paul does lay out exactly our own sin and brokenness in which we all participate in this painful and sorrowful world of ours, but it calls us to something else, to be renewed, to be reborn. And the place where that happens for us is with the promises at the font, with the water. And the word, claimed into that same life and death and resurrection of Jesus, that it changes us and sets us in a new course. And then there's this passage from John. And normally on Reformation, we hear those words, "and the truth will set you free." We get all very excited because we think, now we've got it, right? Well, sometimes actions speak better than words. And if you engage this story a little bit, you can see how absolutely radical it is. Now, we don't wash feet in our society. I don't even like feet all that much. But it was a real thing then. When you came in from a journey and you were visiting someone's house, it was expected that you could wash up. So if it was just your friend or maybe your relative or you were not a rich person, you'd probably set out some water in a basin and someone could do it for themselves. That seems to speak to our doing your own spirituality today, doesn't it? So that could happen. But if you had some means, what you would do is you would have a person there to do that. So when people came in off of the dirty, dusty roads, filled with all kinds of things you could step in, just like Wednesday when the septic tank went. You're dirty, right? And you'd have somebody there to wash you up, to make things right. To get all of that filth off of you, to honor the journey that you were on that got you there, but now to say you're welcome here and you're part of this household and you're one of us. Most of the time, those people were invisible, right? They just kind of did their thing, got you ready, and you can move on to the party. Jesus takes that position. The person who should be invisible becomes the most visible of all. It's not hygiene I'm after, it's holiness, he tells Peter. Not just a little part of me, all of me. Peter responds. And then he hands us the towel. He hands us the basin. You have the pattern. As I do, now you do. How radical is that? For all of us. To live in this world that is so divided, and instead get on our knees and hands with Jesus, a bowl of water, and say, let's get cleaned up. It's that promise that we keep returning it to time and time again, week in and week out, there at the font. Remember that you're forgiven. Remember that you're made clean. That is the gift that we keep receiving from Jesus, who shows us how to do it. Not by standing on the top of the highest mountain and shouting. Not by putting people in their place as wrong because we have a superiority complex. Not because we get so angry and frustrated we just lash out like so many people seem to do today. Instead, we're to care for those who are at loss and deep in pain. We are to care for those who have done it to them. You and I have this amazing calling. We have this great gift that our mission statement lifts up, that we are community, that we're people together, that we're building community in Christ, that we serve Christ in the community around us. And we have the model how. In this world, on this day of Reformation, let us remember first off and foremost that the people who first need some reforming is ourselves. That we are welcome back to get cleaned up, just as Christ always offers. But that to make a difference in this world, even a small one, all of us can make a small one. To get on our hands and feet alongside. To welcome others there. And with Jesus, wash some feet. Amen.